Thank you for dropping by to share a little Christmas music. I hope that this offers you a few moments of refreshment and maybe inspiration in these difficult times. It certainly has, for me, been a joy to prepare it, and I'm delighted to play it for you. In the beginning was Bach, and so the music of Bach is never very far from some sort of association, a literary association, a thematic association, a theological association. They are all connected. And yet, the title of the work that you just heard, A Prelude and Fugue, is a completely abstract title. So what's the connection? The great Bach interpreter, the late Marie-Claire Alain, said of this work that she had found in it themes that were taken directly from Bach's Cantata No. 65. Cantata 65 was written for the Feast of the Epiphany, toward the end of Christmastide. And that work was written for performance at the Thomaskirche in Leipzig, where Bach had become the cantor, the director of music, in his very first year. So that would have been 1722. But not only that, if you listen to the figures in the prelude, the first part of that prelude and fugue, you notice two musical gestures, predominant musical gestures. There are these long sweeping downward lines that clearly represent the grace of God in bringing Christ into human vesture as part of the Nativity. And there are these little faulting steps ascending, which suggests these little aspirations and hopes of humankind in response. These two meet, they're merged, and they're combined in this prelude. And so, this is a wonderful work for Christmas. We'll continue with a work by the French composer Marcel Dupré, who flourished in the 20th century, died in the early 1970s. For most of his career, a good part of his career, he was organist of the Church of Saint-Sulpice in Paris, and he composed a valuable, important repertoire for the organ. This work that we're going to hear is taken from a four-movement symphony called the Symphonie-Passion, the Passion Symphony, that itself was born of an improvisation. During the 1920s, Dupré went to play a concert at Wanamaker's department store in Philadelphia. You may know that Wanamaker's still houses the largest pipe organ in the world. Well, an instrument that vies for those honors with its relatively close neighbor, the organ of Boardwalk Hall in Atlantic City, only 40 miles away. Dupré played this recital at the invitation of Rodman Wanamaker, a great fan of the organ and organ literature, and he was asked to improvise, as French players often are. This four-movement symphony, which was his improvisation, depicted four pivotal scenes in the life of Christ: Advent, the world awaiting the Savior; the Nativity, the birth of Jesus; the events, the tumult and the pain and the torture of the Passion of Christ; and the Resurrection. This second movement itself is in three sections, and its Christmas themes will be plainly obvious to you. In the first section, we hear the distant call of the shepherds playing their pipes in the fields. You'll hear that in the various solo registers of the organ. In the second section, he depicts camels bearing the Magi toward Bethlehem. And that's done by these heavy plodding steps and these cords in the left hand. You can see through this the hoofs of the camels going into the sand. And finally, in the third section, the angelic hymn, the angel singing a chorus of Adeste Fidelis, O come all ye faithful, quoted straightforward. Nativité by Marcel Dupré.
Thank you.
George Blum, a German Baroque composer, was said to have had a very important influence on J.S. Bach, although some decades earlier. His choral prelude settings, that is to say, pieces of music founded upon commonly known hymns, were the kinds of music that Bach then reflected in his own output, particularly Lutheran hymns. In this particular case, the hymn is the Allein Gott, All Glory Be to God on High, which reveals another interesting fact of both musical and cultural history. This melody was founded on a much earlier chant melody, a pre-Reformation, obviously, melody, that was the Gloria from the Missa in Tempore Paschali, the Easter Mass. It got appropriated by Martin Luther and the composers following to become a melody associated with Christmas. And so there's a number of settings by Bach of this melody, but also this seminal one by George Blum, this angelic hymn. It's treated in a kind of form that Bach knew very well, learned very well, in imitation. Every phrase of the melody serves as a subject for its own little spinning out, usually culminated by a statement of the melody in the pedal. So, the Allein Gott of George Blum. And I add one little footnote. While it's not necessarily notated in the score or required, you'll hear little bells playing with this, a zimbal stern, a magic star, a cymbal star. Frequently, organs of that period had rotating stars attached to little bells that would add this atmospheric small bell halo around these melodies. The composer Siegfried Kargelert flourished in the early part of the 20th century. He was German. He lived in Leipzig, Bach's hometown. He earned his living as a professor at the Leipzig Conservatory. His music, however, was a blend of sort of Germanic forms and the newly growing forms of French Impressionism, the music of Debussy and Ravel. But of course, during the 1920s and into the 1930s, this would have created a certain dissonance, if you will, with the cultural and even political themes that were current in Germany at the time. And so Kargelert's music was not terribly much in favor in his own homeland in his own day. It took some time following Kargelert's death and an international recognition of his work for that music to be fully accepted and to be played. I'm happy that it's come now much more into the mainstream repertoire. Kargelert wrote a number of works that were based upon German chorales, and the work that you'll hear next is In Dulce Jubilo, the familiar Christmas carol. His treatment of the work is a multi-sectioned variation. It's continuous, but it's in multi-sections. It demands a lot. It's very colorful, it's very muscular, it's very brawny. It demands a lot of the organ and of the organist.
Thank you.
we'll conclude with two more works built on familiar carols and maybe not so familiar carols. The first is by David Thomas, who's a resident of the Twin Cities of Minneapolis. He has an enviable set of commissions and awards in his career. He's been composer in residence in a number of important institutions in his home city. This particular setting of the Appalachian Carol, I Wonder As I Wander, is a fascinating blend of a solo voice against a very free, flute-like, improvisatory counterpoint. It suggests maybe the notion of the dark, mysterious skies and the stars in those skies against this lonely voice singing the Appalachian melody. It is a compelling work and a very brief work. And finally, acknowledging the English organist W.T. Best, composer and organist, who is very well known for his transcriptions and also his indigenous compositions, I'll play for you this fantasy on English carols. Now, this is where the unfamiliar comes to bear also, because these carols include, and I'll read down the list for you, God Rest You Merry Gentlemen, that you will identify readily, A Virgin Most Pure, you may recognize, The Babe of Bethlehem, this is the title, A Rare Song in Praise of Christmas, and that's a new one to me, Ye Chimes, also new to me, and finally, The Boar's Head Carol, which is not at all new to many of us. But these are more than sweet little tunes. They're the basis for a very elaborate kind of development from Best and an orchestral treatment of this instrument that develops the fullest measure of what these melodies offer. And with that, I wish you all a very Merry Christmas.